old plug compared to the new one. I love it. Welcome back to another day off, everybody. It is time to make some progress on the BMW E30. Some more parts have arrived. We have a new starter, intake hose, intake elbow, spark plug wires, all four spark plugs, distributor cap, distributor rotor, as well as vacuum advanced diaphragm, two new engine mounts, a new distributor O-ring, all three belts, sway bar end links plus sway bar bushings. We have some sealing rings for some coolant sensors. We also have a new thermostat, valve cover gasket, oil pan gasket, fuel filter, air filter, transmission filter, front crank seal, and a new power steering bottle reservoir. Now I'm thinking the logical first step is to get the starter in the vehicle. I really want to address the distributor and that leaking vacuum diaphragm. However, in order to do the timing, we need the car to be able to run and fire up properly. This starter has been sticking for a while, so I think it's time to get underneath the intake manifold, get that starter replaced. So you can see the starter's pretty well buried underneath the intake manifold. First step is going to be disconnecting the battery. All right, next I'm gonna get this intake boot out of the way. And I'm also gonna disconnect this hose up here because I have the replacement for it. So we can maybe save it. I also have this elbow down here too. This thing is super cracked. So I have this hose replacement. I also have this little adapter here. I got a replacement for that too. So looking at the old starter, looks like it has a bracket that bolts onto the starter housing. And my local shop that replaced this starter left the hardware out. It's not a big deal, just a small detail, you know, just goes to show if you're paying a professional shop to do a job for you, they don't always do it perfect. So sometimes you're better off doing it yourself. I'm gonna get started with pulling the connections off of the solenoid here. Looks like this has a lock washer as well. Next step is going to be getting down to the bell housing. It's kind of hard to see, but there's a bolt way down there. There's another one down there. So two more bolts that run through the bell housing into the starter, and then this thing should be able to slide out of the front. And we got Sage in the shop today too. She's doing some solar charging. It's a tight fit. Oh, this thing is so heavy. Look at this unit. This looks like an O'Reilly Auto Parts starter too. It's Bosch, but it's a remanufactured Bosch. Reman in Mexico. Okay, so here I have a predicament on this old starter. It looks like they helicoiled it to take that top bolt. On the bottom bolt, it's clean. This new starter, clean threads. So the question is, do I helicoil this new starter for ease of installation, or will I be able to sneak a nut and a wrench back down onto there to tighten up that other bolt? I don't know, because access is pretty damn difficult on this top bolt. I'm gonna test fit this, get this new starter put in, and we'll see what access to that looks like. If not, I'm gonna have to run to the store, buy a helicoil kit for the size of the mounting bolts, and put that in. Well, might as well run to the hardware store, see if they have a helicoil that can fit. Because this thing's going to be so hard to get in. It was already such a pain in the ass. All right, I got the tap and die kit out so I could get my thread gauge. We're looking to get a good match, which we are 1.5 on the thread pitch. And for size, I threaded on the 10 mil by 1.5 die. And it threads on perfect with no play. So I know that this bolt is a 10 millimeter by 1.5. So next we're gonna hit the hardware store, see if they have a helicoil set 10 mil by 1.5. I think this is gonna be the easiest way to get this job done. All right, it only took me about 2 hours of driving around to every single hardware store in the north end of the county to find this thread repair kit. M10 by 1.5. Now we can finally drill and tap and get some threads into this starter. Damn, that took too much time. So our first step would be to drill it out to a 13/32, but because this hole is already that big, our next step is to tap it. Looking pretty clean. Next step is to take the coil attacher, inserter, whatever you want to call it. Thread our coil on. Right, it's bottomed out. This is optional. You don't really don't have to do it, but a little bit of Loctite. Thread our coil in. Well, I test fitted the bolt. I trimmed off the excess off the backside. I think it's gonna work. But there's only one way to find out. Let's get this starter back in the car and see if we can get it mounted up tight. It's taking way too long already. Getting closer. Okay, time for bottom bolt. Finally. All right, starter is tight. And this is the bracket that I'm referring to. Mounts to the body and then a bolt goes into the block. This bolt was not installed last time, so I'm gonna see if I can get it to fit. That's just lightly mocked up, but it looks good. So I'm gonna try to find a bolt that fits that and we'll keep going. No luck finding a smaller bolt, so let's try to cut this one down, make a smaller bolt. Alrighty, the new starter is installed. We even fixed this bracket that the previous shop left uninstalled. I cut that bolt down to size, got it to fit. Bracket is all set to go. Now we just gotta put the intake boot back on, reroute my new intake hose up top, and we'll keep going. Also gonna be replacing this elbow right here, so I'm just gonna get this piece pulled off. There we go. So we got the old elbow. Oh yeah, she was tired. Dang, I'm almost out of wet silicone. Dang, that thing's stiff. There we go. We also got a factory BMW hose reducer. So this hose routes down to the intake boot and we're gonna be replacing this plastic. Get access to the fuel filter and slap that in real quick. All right, there's the top line. I gotta go get changed. Spilled gasoline on my shirt. Fuel filter came loose. Fell down on top of me. Got all over my creeper. Spilled all over the floor. All right, well, I had some audio difficulties, but the fuel filter is out. I spilled it all over my shirt, spilled it all over the creeper, but we're good to go. Next step is I gotta get this new filter in and mounted. Boy, this fuel filter design sucks. I got those two hose clamps tight. They wrap around a bracket and hold the fuel filter to the bracket. So those are tight. I'm gonna do the bottom hose now and then fasten the top and we'll be good to go. I'm gonna give you a quick look of the fuel filter from the bottom. You can see there's my lower fuel hose I disconnected and there's my two hose clamps. It's not terrible, it's just kicking my ass. E46 design is much easier, so we're in good shape. Lower hose is connected. I could smell fuel before I started the fuel filter. replacement, and those two hose clamps looked a little bit wet, so I snugged them up and I was able to get some good turns out of them. So we'll have to double check that in the future for a potential slight fuel seepage. Back on. I'm about to put the airbox in next, but I want to bump this battery, or I want to bump this starter over to make sure it actually works. All right, let's bump this starter over, see what happens. All right. Whoa. It shouldn't be ticking like that. What's going on? Ugh, I cannot pull this starter back out. Is that a battery issue? Well, we need to get the mass airflow sensor plugged back in, and we need to get the airbox put back in. It's still sticking. Why would it do that? I have no idea. It shouldn't be low battery. It fired up first crank, and then the second crank, it just clicked like the starter was sticking, but the starter's brand new. It shouldn't be sticking. I sure as hell am not pulling that starter back out today. That sucked. Let's get an easy win here. Love to see it. Let's see how this thing wants to crank over now. Man, I'm really hoping this starter is gonna come to life, because I do not have the heart to get that starter out again. It's a nice strong crank. It's running good. I'm gonna let it run for a sec. Get the battery charged up. All right, that's a good sign. Starter's working every time. All right, I think we're in business. Woo, feel a little bit better after that now. What have you been up to, huh? Were you digging? Were you digging and burying your little snoot in the mud? Well guys, she's running good. We still need to address that vacuum leak at the distributor, but at least the starter's working strong. So that's a positive. Everything seems to be working well. Car's running strong. I didn't get nearly as much done as I wanted to, but we did get the new starter in. We did replace our intake elbow, our intake hose. We got the new air filter installed, and we got that new fuel filter installed. Tomorrow morning, I'm gonna hit the gym, and then we're going to work on going through the distributor. I'm gonna get the engine to TDC, pull the distributor apart, get all those new components installed, and then I'm going to learn how to set ignition timing, because that's something I've never done. But we did make some pretty decent progress today, so I'll see you guys in the morning. All right, it's the next day. This is what's going on. I pulled the airbox back out, threw in my Autoline Pro intake adapter. We're gonna get the Ventus fired up. See all this smoke we got dumping out of the distributor? That is today's issue. And the reason why that is leaking vacuum, well, we have the Ventus plumbed up to the intake boot, and that's plumbing our intake system with smoke. That then runs over to this little vacuum hose. That runs up here to this switch. That switch runs over here to the vacuum advance diaphragm for the distributor. Now, I know that this vacuum advance for the distributor is leaking because what I did, the Ventus kit comes with a bunch of adapters, but it comes with these handy little plugs. Now, if we were to disconnect the vacuum line off of the vacuum advance and plug it. So, because we use that plug and plug this vacuum line that goes to the vacuum advance diaphragm for the distributor, we no longer have any smoke seeping out of the distributor. So, we know that this diaphragm is torn inside, vacuum is bypassing into the distributor, and then it's leaking out of the weep hole on the bottom of the housing. So, that's a confirmed diagnosis for a torn diaphragm in the vacuum advance. So, with that being said, today's goal is to replace that vacuum advance diaphragm. I had to order this from Europe. Took a couple weeks, but it's finally here. We also have the distributor cap, the distributor rotor, four new spark plugs, the distributor O-ring, as well as a set of plug wires. Now, I'm a little hesitant. This is my first time tearing into a distributor and dealing with ignition timing. However, I do have a timing light, so we should be able to fumble our way through it. But I think the first part of today is going to be going to the hardware store for a 30 millimeter socket because I have a 27, a 32, and a 36, and the front crank is a 30 millimeter, and we need to get that turned to the top dead center position. 30 mil socket has been obtained. This little nub right here is the timing mark. See that little rusty notch on there lined up with that pin? I think that's TDC for the crankshaft. So we'll go to the distributor and see if I'm correct. There's a little notch on the distributor housing right there that the rotor should be pointing towards. So that indicates that the rotor is in the TDC position, which matches my crankshaft. Just kidding. I think that this rotor is supposed to be the other way around based off what I'm seeing on the Bentley manual. So this is 180 off, I think. I think I was using the incorrect timing mark for the crank. So I'm gonna rotate the crank here and go off the distributor rotor. That's pretty much dead on. Now I'm gonna check the crankshaft. So now I have this lined up with this mark. It's impossible to get you guys a shot, guys, but I had the crankshaft 180 degrees off. So now that little nub is lined up with one of those notches on the backside of that crank pulley here. So I know that that's timed up as well. I got that rotor lined up. I'm gonna disconnect this plug, pull the vacuum advance off, remove the rotor, and then remove the dust cap and loosen this 10 mil nut for the distributor. Okay, distributor is removed. We don't have any oil bypassing the seal, which is good, but we will replace it anyways. And next we'll have to get access to the vacuum advance. And we'll cover this up just in case. Here we have our vacuum control. This, I believe, is our pulse transmitter. I'm not sure if this needs to come out for the vacuum control or not. So I'm just gonna break this loose and see if we can get access and remove it without having to take this whole thing apart. Let's tear into this box for the new vacuum control. This thing traveled from, I think, Latvia. I just could not find this vacuum control anywhere. Pretty cool. You can see when the lever gets pulled via vacuum, the whole pulse transmitter rotates. I don't have to take the pulse transmitter out. I was able to just pull this down and disconnect it from that little nub right there. New distributor O-ring from FCP. You know we gotta hit it with some Sill Glide. Distributor O-ring is installed. Time to attempt to get this distributor back in. Installation note says that you should clock it about 30 degrees. I assume to make up for the amount that the distributor is going to spin with the teeth. So we're gonna do that. Roughly 30 degrees from where I had it. I mean, I'm not really sure where it's supposed to be. I just know that we're gonna have to adjust timing after we're done with this. Dust cover goes. Rotor. Maybe we can pull it out and get it line back up. That way when I dropped it down and the rotor spun, it lined right back up with the hash mark that I was going for. Rotor still lined up nicely. That's one, three, coil, two. Now I'm gonna replace these plug wires when I'm done timing. And here's a look at our old cap. And our old rotor was worn pretty well too. You can see it actually has a little chip out of it right here as well. Distributor is installed. The nut is still loose, so I'm able to turn it a little bit. The firing order on this distributor is 1, 3, 4, 2. I have all the plug wires back in the correct position. I have the cooling fan reinstalled and I have the airbox reinstalled for all those sensors to be plugged in. I'm gonna do the spark plugs and the wires after we set the timing. I don't want there to be any potential issues with the new wires or the new plugs until after I get the timing figured out, because I know this setup is still okay and I don't wanna refresh the entire system and then fire the car up and find out that something isn't working. There is a hole right down there, and that is for shining the timing light to figure out the correct timing. I have my new timing light here that I need to get unboxed. This is a timing light that does show RPMs. I did some research online and everybody says that the ones that can display RPM are the most helpful. So I'm gonna fire the car up just to see if it runs. We need to get it up to operating temperature and then I'll worry about getting the timing light correct. But I just wanna fire it up and see if it'll run at the current ignition timing that it's at. And the vacuum advance is currently unplugged and capped off with the Ventus plug. Wish me luck. All right, I must have gotten the distributor back to a decent position. Now I need to get it up to operating temperature. Could be running out of fuel. I'm gonna clip that onto spark plug number one. That's gonna pick up tack. positive. 730 RPM. I need to get that up to, I think, like 2200, 2250. All right, that's gonna have to be good enough. Well, I thought I had timing correct, and then I pulled my prop rod off the throttle and my idle came down and it's sitting at like 1400 RPM. So something about me adjusting the timing funny bumped up the idle a bunch. So I gotta do some more research real quick. So we're still at about 1400 RPM. I timed it to 25 degrees, visible through the oblong hole down there. Attempted to adjust the idle through the idle stop screw down there on the bottom of the throttle body. I think it needs to be adjusted through here. There's an increase. And that's all the way shut. And we're still at 1400 RPM. So I'm not sure how to get the idle back down. Well guys, this thing is kicking my ass. Sketch. Going for a drive. That suspension is so squishy. I love it. It's like a rolling couch. That's my girl. Thanks. Maiden voyage. Yeah, it's a project car right now. I don't have a card. You can check out my channel though if you'd like. It's called Day Off DIY. Okay. And I help out locals too, you know. Yeah. Someone needs, you know, some basic services on cars and stuff. That feels good. We're gonna hit the highway and we're gonna give this thing the nuts. It shouldn't even be on the highway, but see how she pulls. Ready? Brake check. I ain't got much to complain about on that road test right there. So to finish up for today, I was thinking let's knock out some plugs and wires and we'll hit it hard again tomorrow. This gap is massive on this old plug compared to the new one. Part number on this is WR9DC, WR9DC, Russia, Brazil. We're replacing the Brazilian plugs with some Russian plugs. I don't know any Russian, or else I'd say something Russian right now. We'll do 25 Newton meters for these. So I do all my other plugs at. I know why the wire's not going on. So these new plugs have a conventional tip. You gotta break them loose. And you gotta unscrew it to get it to the threaded bit for it to bite. I've never had to do that before. There we go. What the hell? Now it jumps up to 13. Day 3, we left off last night putting in a fresh set of spark plug wires. Let's fire this thing up, see how it does on cold start. I like the idle. It was up at like 1700 last night, but that idle's a lot better. Ooh. Now it's down to like 800 or 900. The way I had it timed, the idle was like up at 1600. Let's take her out for another rip. I wanna see if the timing is still good with the idle being back down a lot lower than it was last night. Come on, Sage. Load up. Good girl. Oh, it's gutless right now. Gotta love old shop connections. I just called my old boss, Ron, over at Coast Motorwork in Huntington Beach. He gave me the rundown on getting this thing timed up properly. Says we're looking for 18 to 2500 RPM, 32 degrees total advance off of the TDC indicator. But before we do that, we're gonna need to do some fine tuning at the throttle body to make sure that the idle is adjusted properly. So let's jump in there and we'll get back to work today. So what I'm trying to achieve right now is I'm trying to get the throttle body to not stay closed completely, but to be open a little bit when we're sitting at idle. Right now with the throttle stop completely backed out, the throttle body's sitting completely closed. So I'm gonna adjust it to where it's cracked just a hair. I wonder if I could have just adjusted it through here. So that's looking better, but now there's a little bit of slop in my throttle cable. So I'm gonna have to adjust this throttle cable a little bit. I never use adjustable wrenches. Don't judge me. Put this back together and attempt to time this one more time. What happened right there? All of a sudden the RPMs just fall off. I don't get it. Something's going on with that. So here I got a nickel and I drilled a 3/16 hole in it. I'm gonna pull off this idle air control and I'm gonna place this nickel down inside this elbow right here. What that does is it limits the idle circuit. It limits the amount of airflow entering the engine and it's supposed to drop the idle down. I've done a lot of research over the last couple days on getting this engine's idle figured out as well as timing it. And a lot of people have a high idle issue after they get their timing dialed in. Sometimes the control valve can go bad. Sometimes the unit, the control unit that controls that inside the glove box can go bad. I got the timing to where I want it, but my idle is still really high. So I'm gonna pull this off and give it a shot. And install it. I'm just looking for some improvement. If it fixed it, that would be bitching because I have the timing where it needs to be, I believe. Still need to drive it. Guys, that's idling like perfect. 1,000 RPM. Timing is still where we need it to be. Let's go take this thing for a drive. This could be really good, guys. Any tools? Any tools? No tools. Sunroof yesterday wasn't working. There we go. Just needed a little encouragement. Might be a ping. Yeah, it's got a little ping. I'm gonna have to go back and back it out. Running good now. 80 miles an hour at 4,100 RPM. Here comes a brake check. She brakes good. So idle right now in park is at about 1,300 RPM. Drop it into drive. It's at about 900. I'm happy. Another thing I'm curious about is these sunroof drains. So let's pour some water down them and see if they're draining. Well, sunroof drain is working. Rear drain is working. That drain is working. Hey, there we go. It works. It might just be a little plugged, but it's working. Guys, this car is starting to run better and better, and it's working better and better, and starting to really fall in love with it. However, don't get me wrong, she will be for sale. So if you guys are interested, shoot me an email, shoot me an offer. Everything's for sale for the right price. Check out my chickens, guys. I got my run constructed, got the door put on. Still needs a little bit of fine tuning, but I just got the electronic chicken door installed this week. So all my chickies got a run now. They're happy. Their combs are growing in. What's up, guys? They sure are pretty. But they're getting so big, should have eggs in, I don't know, a month or two, I think. Not sure what the exact time frame is, but they're a lot happier out here. They got some room to stretch out. I'm gonna build some stuff too, maybe a little swing, you know, hang it down. Maybe put some stuff out here to keep them entertained, but it's nice to get them outside the coop. Got the electronic coop defender chicken door up on there. My girlfriend gave that to me, it was used, but happy chickens. So to finish things out for today's video, I got the pressure washer hooked up. We're gonna give this engine bay a proper cleaning. We got more work to do in future episodes, but we need to get all this grease and grime out of here, and I wanna see if the underside of this hood will clean up any good. And we need to spray out all these and strut towers and all down here and stuff and just get it looking better. But now that I got it running nice and clean, I'm confident enough to spray it down with some water. Well, she's looking better already. She's running better, idling better, driving better, making lots of progress on the old 318. See, idles at about 1,000 in park, I like that. Well guys, that's gonna wrap this one up, I think. In total, we replaced the starter, the fuel filter, the air filter, the idle air control hose, and that idle air control elbow. We did the nickel trick with the 3/16 hole drilled in it to drop the idle back down. We replaced the distributor vacuum advance, the distributor O-ring, the cap, the rotor, spark plugs, and spark plug wires, and we adjusted the ignition timing. We still have so much more work left to do on this thing. I still need to do engine mounts, all three belts, front crank seal, valve cover gasket, valve adjustment, oil pan gasket, all of the fluids. I also want to give a quick shout out to Colby's Car Corner and to Denise, the previous owner of this 318, for jumping into my membership program. I really appreciate the support. Thank you very much. You guys keep an eye out for Denise's name down in the comments. She's been watching the series and been really enjoying it, and it's really cool to just see some dialogue from the previous owner in the comments there. I thought you might enjoy that. As always, folks, I hope you enjoyed, or I hope you learned something new. And if you enjoyed this video, check out one of these videos up here. I will see you on my next day off, everybody. Cheers.